by Professor Cathie Martin. This is our Janaki Amal Chair for the Chair Lecture for the 2020 year. Because of the pandemic, we have been hugely delayed. Professor Martin was to visit India. Unfortunately, she wasn't able to undertake the visit in spite of all preparations that were undertaken. And I do wish to express my deep gratitude to her for the trouble that she has taken in delivering these lectures online. And like I said in the last lecture, that anytime she's ready and anytime the travel advisories are gone, we hope that she will be able to come to India and we will support her visit to India and take her around, and hopefully she'll be able to interact with some of our students and faculty members. Also wish to take this opportunity to express my deep gratitude to Dr. Shubhra Chakraborty, who is the director of the National Institute of Plant Genomics Research, because Cathie is a friend of Shubhra, and as a matter of fact, Shubhra actually helped the Academy reach out to her, and and we are grateful that Cathie has kindly agreed and accepted. I'm also very grateful to Sumesh for organizing all of the technical aspects of this online lecture. I will hand over the microphone to Shubhra so that she can introduce Professor Martin and also conduct the rest of the session, including the Q&A session. So thank you all once again, and thank you, Professor Martin, for engaging with us. And again, like I said, that we hope that we'll be able to meet in person shortly.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Shubhra, would you take over?
Yeah, thank you, Professor Majumdar. First of all, I think I should thank you and the Academy to give me an opportunity to bring Cathie into our the community of the scientists in India. And of course, we are grateful to Cathie that she agreed and she is delivering today the second lecture. So I know by now, Professor Cathie Martin is already known to our all fellows and the students who all already have heard her 2 weeks back. But again, as customary, I would like to introduce, it's my pleasure and honor to introduce Professor Cathie Martin, who is a professor of plant sciences at the University of East Anglia and also a group leader at the John Nis Center at Norwich. And she earned her honors in natural science and got the doctorate in biochemistry from the University of Cambridge. And then she is also appointed as a member of the British Empire in 2013 birthday honors for her service to plant biotechnology. And I'm sure the students and faculties who are from the plant science field knows Cathie by her very, very nice and very, insightful work in the plant science and plant biotechnology. She was also appointed as a British Empire in 2013. And in 2014, she was named as the most promising innovator by the Biotechnology and Biological Science Research Council, that is popularly known as BBSRC, that we all know it. She is also an elected fellow of the Royal Society of London. And also this year, she has been awarded as the rank prize of nutrition, and that which I think is very close to Cathie's heart. And her research interest actually spans from very wide, I would say. It spans from the fundamental to the applied plant biology. And she is known for her research that has sought to elucidate a relationship between the diet and the health, human health, and how biofortification of crop can improve diet, and that can address the global challenge that all of us face year after year of the increasing chronic diseases. And that related to that work, we have already heard her speaking 2 weeks back to give her first lecture under this Janaki Amal Chair Lectureship. And in this work, actually her laboratory has combined, I would say, which is very rare in worldwide, that if we see, we work in silos. So when we work in plant, we work in plant. When we work in nutrition or in medical science, it's in silos. But Cathie's, I think, main contribution is how to combine the clinical nutrition with epidemiology and also to actually, combine the, I would say from her work that combining the metabolic pathways and the plant biotechnology for the agricultural improvement that can in turn give us a better food for us to have a healthy life. So now Cathie not only works in that area, but Cathie's lab extensively has contributed in another area, which is her fundamental research towards understanding of cellular specialization and how, you know, specially shaped cells, plant has different cells, and specially shaped cells can help adapt the plants to the changing environment. The climatic change is a very, very important area, and Cathie has contributed with her students and colleagues and collaborators in this area extensively. And therefore, I now invite Professor Martin to deliver her second Jubilee Chair Professor 2020 lecture in the same area, and which all of you know is entitled The Mystery of Hairy Tomatoes, Identifying Natural Variation Controlling Trichome Formation in Tomatoes. So this trichome is a those specialized cell for today. And I just saw this first slide and I was asking Cathie, from where did you gather this? And she says it's a storybook first page. So it's very nice connection actually for Hairy Tomato story and her work. We are all really honored to have you, Cathie, with us. And I'm glad that you could join us virtually to deliver these two lectures despite your busy schedule, and looking forward to have you with us physically in India sometime, maybe next year. And I'm really grateful to the Academy, particularly Professor Partha Mojumdar, the President of the Academy, to extend that opportunity to all of us to have Cathie with us maybe next year, and also to Cathie to agree for that. So with that, I think I would request Cathie to start your lecture for the day, and over to you, Cathie. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kuba and Partha, for your fantastic introduction. Too glowing, really. But so today I'm going to talk about some more fundamental research that we have done over the years. And as Subra mentioned, I've entitled it The Mystery of the Hairy Tomatoes, which is a children's book by an author called George E. Stanley. And I don't think it has an awful lot of relevance to what I'm going to talk, except I'm going to talk about hairs, and I'm going to talk about hairs and tomatoes. But I do like the subtitle of this talk, which is Third Grade Detectives. And I think that that's a good summary of the way that we approach this research, which is an incredibly complicated area of biology. Anyway, let's get on with the story. So the story really begins almost 30 years ago with the discovery of a mutation in the what was my model organism at the time, that is Antirrhinum majus. And I discovered, I did discover this mutant because I was interested in the control of color in the flowers. Now, this is the wild type Antirrhinum flower, and this is the mutant. And looking at it, you would probably say there's very little difference between these two flowers. How on earth can you see a mutation there? But in fact, if you look carefully at the wild type flower in this area of the petal, it's paler than this outer area, which is darker. And in the mutant, it's the same pale color all over. Now, we were very lucky when we discovered this mutation that we had what was called in those days an unstable allele. And this is a mutation caused by insertion of a transposable element. And when a transposable element inserts into a locus to cause a mutation, the type 2 transposable elements can jump out again and you get a reversion of the phenotype. And this is the unstable mutant. And I hope you can see, but perhaps you can't, that there are some dark sectors on the petals. And a pale background. even if you can't see it on the picture of the flower, if you look under the microscope, then you can see that here in panel D, that there is a paler mutant background, and then these wild type revertant sectors. And we spent a lot of time trying to find out whether there was more anthocyanin in the sectors. So we thought that this might be an intensifier gene. But we didn't make any progress with thinking that along the lines that this was due to some cells, the wild type cells, having more anthocyanins in them. And then I remembered a comment that had been made to me by one of my really fantastic students, David Jackson, who's now at Cold Spring Harbor. And he said, you know, sometimes the shape of cells can affect the colors on petals. This is some very old and quite obscure publication. So I asked our scanning electron microscopist to take a look at these unstable mutant petals. And here's the pictures that are kind of aligned. So this is a microscopic blow up of the petal cells of the unstable mutant. Here you can see the darker wild type revertant sectors. And when we looked under the scanning electron microscope, you could also see sectors in the shape of the cells. So these are wild type conical cells, and they're present on the petals of a large number of flowers, and they help to increase the visibility, the shine, and the intensity of pigment that you see, even though the amount of pigment in these cells and these cells is similar. And these are the flat mutant cells. So it turned out that this gene, which is reverting in the unstable form to wild type in these conical cells, is a transcription factor, and this dictate, or this is required for making the cells conical on the surface of the petals. And that was the start of our journey towards understanding trichomes, and how that happened I'll explain in a minute. So a single transcription factor can change the shape of petal cells. Now, when we express the mixed transcription factor in tobacco, we saw, so this is an ectopic expression using the 35S promoter from cauliflower mosaic virus. Then we saw the leaf cells of tobacco did form a kind of conical shape. It wasn't exactly a cone, but it was an outgrowth on most of the cells. But on some of the cells, we also saw the formation of multicellular trichomes. So this one's got a conical cell, but it's also had a cell division here and another cell division. And I think there's another one here to make a three-cell trichome. So this led us to a model that, in fact, the conical cell was a sort of trichoblast. It was an immature form of a multicellular trichome. And that in petal cells, the conical cells were arrested at this stage, but on leaf cells, there was there could be a progression, not always, but there could be a progression towards further cell divisions and the formation of a multicellular hair or trichome. And that perhaps in with further expression of the mixture gene, then you could have these outgrowths on the cells of the trichome, and so you could get a branch. So this was quite a simple model, and we refined it a little bit by some molecular analysis that suggested that one of the major, and it's not rocket science to project this, but that the difference between a conical cell and a multicellular trichome was the ability of the cells to undergo further rounds of cell division. So the relationship between the promotion or cell determination by the mixture gene, the outcome of that, the developmental outcome, was determined by whether the cells could go on dividing. In petal cells, they can't. And in leaf cells, yes, if the mixture gene is expressed early, then the cells can go on dividing and form a multicellular trichome. So this is a very simple model of how in tobacco or indeed in Antirrhinum, and this is a picture of an Antirrhinum leaf ectopically expressing the mixture gene. And here you can see most of the epidermal cells are forming these conical cells, but there are also ectopic multicellular trichomes developing. And here's a conical cell developing on one of the trichome cells. So at least in Antirrhinum and Tobacco, which are both members of the Euastrid clade, then trichome initiation, we believed, could be initiated and stimulated by a mixture-like transcription factor. And further analysis in Antirrhinum suggested, in fact, that there were a number of genes that looked like mixture. I should say that mixture is an R2R3 MIB transcription factor, but it doesn't cluster with those that control anthocyanin biosynthesis. And we found two kind of clades of mixture-like proteins. It's the terminology in this field is absolutely dreadful. So I'll refer to mixture and mixture-like proteins. So in Antirrhinum, there were two mixture proteins, which we called mixture one and mixture. This was the one that we found was mutated. And there were also some of mixture-like proteins, which were we labeled ML2 and ML3. And ML2 was very similar to a protein or a gene in Petunia, which had already been described, which was called PHMIB1. Now, PHMIB1, there's also an unstable allele of, which was discovered by Dutch group led by Ronald Coos. And Ronald was kind enough to send us this unstable mutant line. And so we did a little bit more work on looking at the phenotype of PHMIB1, because Antirrhinum is a difficult model to work on. We didn't have mutants of mixture-like 2 to compare. And PHMIB1, the unstable line has a transposon in it, and this can jump out to create revertant sectors. And the revertant sectors of PHMIB1 are darker than the mutant flower, as shown in this picture. And so it looked to have be phenocopying the mixture mutation very closely. When we looked under the scanning electron microscope, we could see that there was a difference in the shape of the cells between the revertant sectors and the flat sectors here. But the mutant sectors. But when we looked in freeze fracture of these different parts of the unstable petunia line, we saw that the mutant line, there were cones on the petal epidermal cells, but they just weren't as big as the cones in the wild type revertant sectors. So this PHMIB1, which is equivalent to the mixture-like protein in Antirrhinum, doesn't have exactly the same function in terms of cell determination. And this will be important when I come back to it later. So it doesn't seem to initiate the cone, it seems to extend the growth of the cone. And lots of people have worked on this particular type of transcription factor, because it's present even in Arabidopsis. It seems to also initiate the production of cuticles. So this it has a slightly different function compared to the mixture gene itself. So our little model for how mixture and mixture-like 2 might work together, or that you can replace this with PHMIB1 as well, it's functionally equivalent, is that mixture initiates the cone, and then mixture-like 2, which is a related transcription factor, and I'll call it mixture-like, promotes the outgrowth of the conical cell. Now, all of this is very interesting, but it was definitely in conflict with a huge amount of work that was going on at the time on the initiation of trichomes in Arabidopsis. And I'm not trying to say that any of this work in Arabidopsis is wrong. It's just that I don't believe that the control of trichome initiation in Arabidopsis extends much beyond the Brassicaceae, because Arabidopsis doesn't have a mixtur gene. So that's the important thing. So it has a completely different way, a different way of initiating its large single-cell trichomes. And this is classic work done by many, many people who defined what is essentially an MBW complex of transcription factors and associated proteins, the TTG1 protein, that initiates the formation of the multicellular trichomes. And they've done fantastic work on patterning as well, which shows that there is a lateral inhibition mechanism to pattern trichomes on the leaves of Arabidopsis. Glabrous 1 is also an R2, R3 MIB transcription factor, but it is not equivalent to the mixtur gene. And if you try to ectopically express mixtur, which is missing in Arabidopsis, it has absolutely no phenotype at all. It doesn't work in Arabidopsis. So what I'm going to try and argue is that this model for trichome initiation in Arabidopsis is rather specific to the Brassicaceae. And that may be a function because these are very large single-cell trichomes. There's no cell division. And an important component of the initiation of trichomes is an endoreduplication. So this is a multiplication of the chromosome. So you can get up to about 32 times DNA in the nuclei of these large single-cell trichomes. Clearly, in multicellular trichomes, where you have to have cell divisions, there is not the same initial endoreduplication, because there's a general rule that if the cell endoreduplicates, it then doesn't go on to divide, or it's very difficult, or very uncommon for it to divide. So what I'm going to try and present to you is analysis of the trichome developmental pathway with a perspective from mixtur and mixtur-like transcription factors and contrast that with the Arabidopsis pathway, because I believe that there is a uniquely different mechanism of initiation and development of trichomes in almost all other plant species. And because I think that there's gathering evidence that this view is actually correct. So let's have a look at tomato trichomes. This is a very beautiful scanning electron micrograph. And the first thing that you notice, this is a stem. And the first thing that you notice is that there's a lot of different trichome types compared to Arabidopsis, which just has the large branched single cell trichomes. So these large ones here are called type 1 trichomes, and they very often have a glandular head which exudes acyl sugars. There's type 2 and 3 are not very common. This is a type 4, no, this is not, this, I haven't got a type 4 on here, which is a smaller version of type 1. Then there's type 5, which is an aglandular trichome, and then type 6, which is this type of medium-sized capitate trichome with a large four glandular cells at the top, and this is thought to produce terpenoids. And finally, there's type 7, which you can see here, which is a sort of recumbent type of trichome, which it tends to has a glandular head and tends to lie along vascular tissue. So these types of trichomes are summarized in this rather nice drawing here by Luckwell from 1943. And as general points from all these different types of trichomes that you see on tomato, all the trichomes are multicellular, unlike in Arabidopsis, where they're all unicellular. Only type 5 trichomes are aglandular, whereas Arabidopsis trichomes are aglandular. And type 1 and type 4 are probably what we call homeologous. So they may well have the same developmental pathway. They differ mostly in size. And whether size is a developmentally determined is not entirely clear. And type 5 may well be the form that predominates and replaces type 4 in the adult vegetative phase, so that tomato undergoes a phase transition in its vegetative growth from the first 2 or 3 leaves that come out are juvenile, and then the later leaves are adult phase, and type 5 aglandular trichomes predominate on the adult phase of the leaves. So the next thing I wanted to introduce you to is the tomato introgression lines, and particularly the Solanum lycopersicum by Solanum pinellii introgression lines. And these are such a fantastic tool for doing any work in tomato. And I want to just spend a couple of minutes explaining why that is. They were developed by Danny Zamir back in the 1990s, and they have been so widely used for mapping traits and identifying genes. It's unbelievable. What they consist is of a wide species cross between the Solanum pinellii, which is a green-fruited tomato cousin, if you like, and Solanum lycopersicum. And then in the F2, there was repeated back crossing to domesticated tomato parent, such that Danny was able to develop, I think it's 76 introgression lines, which each carry homozygous a piece of the Solanum pinellii genome. So that on introgression line 1.1, you have homozygous, just the first end of chromosome 1 introgressed. And that goes across all 76 lines, so that in introgression line 12.4, you have just this piece of chromosome 4, chromosome 12 introgressed into, from Solanum pinellii introgressed into Solanum lycopersicum background. And this means that any variation between genes in Solanum pinellii, which is a stress tolerant and highly hairy tomato species, any variation can be mapped using by growing up the 76 introgression lines. So it's much, pinellii is much hairier than Solanum lycopersicum. And you can also do a lot of metabolite analysis and use these lines for mapping many, many traits. I can't emphasize strongly enough how useful they are. Encouraged a fantastic student of mine, Javier Galdon Armero, to start his PhD by basically characterizing by scanning electron microscopy and counting the trichome density of all of the introgression lines. And he didn't enjoy doing this very much. He did it over 2 generations, so the data are reasonably robust. And this is a basic summary of trichome density across the introgression lines. We don't have on this the pinellii parent, but it's very hairy. So much hairier than the M82, the domesticated tomato variety. And you can see that there are some introgression lines that had very low levels of trichomes, and some that had a significantly higher density. And so we were able to map new alleles controlling the variation in trichome density. And I want to describe some of the results that came out of this analysis. So we were particularly interested in a region that was defined on chromosome 2. I'll go back to the slide before here. So it's this region 5 and 6, which were not significantly above the M82 line, but for the particular chromosome 2 that they were on, they were significantly higher. Well, they were notably higher density, trichome density, than the other introgression lines on this chromosome. So we thought that this would be interesting to look at. And with the introgression lines, when you look at in detail at the introgression lines, these have all been mapped so that you know exactly the sequence where the breaks are. Then we found that IL-2.6 and IL-2.5 seem to have this as higher elevated trichome density. So we looked for candidate genes within these intervals, which have all been sequenced. And I want to just give you a bit more information about the phenotype that we discovered on IL-2.6 and 2.5. So there's a clustering of trichomes here and here on this introgression line 2.5. And these can be type 4 trichomes or type 5 trichomes can be clustered. Here's some more. And they were also observed on 2.6. And there seemed to be a somewhat higher density of trichomes on in these two introgression lines. So looking at candidate genes, we were able to identify one candidate gene from the mixture-like clade of genes that might be a good candidate gene for affecting this. And this was mixture-like. So I've described mixture-like like in petunia, which is also a solanaceous plant, as affecting conical cell development on petals. Mixture-like had also been described by Asas Aroni's lab to affect conical cell development on fruit, but it had never been reported to have any phenotype outside of fruit. And here we were looking at a phenotype that was affecting trichome density on leaves. And so we investigated the functionality of mixture-like from tomato in greater detail. So if we look at the relative expression of mixture-like across the introgression line population in leaves, then we see that in IL-2.5 and 2.6 in particular, it has very low expression. And so this suggested that perhaps in Solanum pinellii, the mixture-like gene might be inactivated. And the higher trichome density that we were observing in that clustering might be a function of loss of function of this gene. So in order to investigate this more closely, we generated mixture-like knockouts using CRISPR-Cas9. And I'm not going to describe exactly what we did there. I'm going to describe the phenotypes. So checking first of all that mixture-like knockout alleles had the same phenotype as the petunia mutants that we had looked at, the PHMIB1 mutants. We looked at the shape of the petal cells compared to wild-type petal cells. So you can see these very nice conical cells on the petals of the wild-type, and they are not present as such strong conical cells on the petals of the mixture-like knockout. They are a little bit coned, but this is exactly the same as in petunia. They are not completely flat, but they are much flatter than in the wild type. And when we overexpress mixture-like in tomato, then we saw that the petal cells were more conical. So it seems to promote the formation of the extension of these cones, which is very similar to the model that we had from flowers of petunia. if we looked at the fruit, as SF's group had already described, this is the wild-type conical cells on the surface of the tomato fruit. And when you knock out mixed alike, then you see flat cells on the fruit. So this was also confirmed by SF by doing RNAi on these genes. But we were interested in the phenotype in leaves because this was affecting, seemed to affect trichome density. So just to reiterate, in our knockout lines, we also saw a clustering of trichomes, as we had seen in the introgression lines with the gene from Solanum pinellii. And these could be clustering of type 5 trichomes, a mixed clustering of type 6 and a type 4 trichome here, or two type 7 trichomes adjacent. I think these pictures are really cute. When we looked at the mature leaves with their mixed and knockout compared to a moneymaker control, that's the wild type control, then you can see that the trichome density increased substantially, well, significantly, I would say. And these are data to quantify that. So looking at the trichome density on juvenile and adult leaves in the control compared to the CRISPR knockout line, then there was a significant increase in trichome density. Now, I should say that earlier work of ours had suggested that in tomato, there is a relationship, particularly under droughted conditions, where trichomes, if you have more trichomes on a leaf, then you have fewer stomata. And what was very interesting as well was that we could count the stomatal density on the leaves, and that in the mutant, that was also significantly increased compared to the control. So that counter or contradicted what we had found in earlier studies of other introgression lines and other plants under certain conditions, that increase in trichome density did not result in a decrease in stomatal density. So here is the a plot of the relationship between trichome density and stomatal density in our introgression lines that had variable trichome densities, not including this knockout line. Okay, you can see there is a reasonably good association. But when we put in our mixed alike knockouts, then these fall off the line that can be found with moneymakers, so that it looks like mixed alike might also be the gene that is mediating the relationship between increasing the inverse relationship between trichome density and stomatal density. I hope that's absolutely clear. Anyway, where is mixed alike expressed? Well, it's expressed. This is promoter Gus fusion in tomato, and it's expressed in the epidermal cells at the base of the trichomes. In type 7 trichomes, there was also expression in the glandular head, and in the type 6 trichomes, there was expression, quite strong expression in the glandular head, but there was also expression in the base of the cells. There was no expression in the main body of the type 4 trichomes or type 5 trichomes that we could see. And so this suggests that perhaps mixed-alike is active in these basal cells and that it has a negative effect on stomatal, on the density of stomata and the density of trichomes. So I want to now progress to examining the effect of another mixture gene. This is not mixed alike. This is mixture, and it's, but it's another mixed gene that looks like mixture in tomato. In antirrhinum. And this came about by examining this very low trichome density integration line 4.1. In fact, it's also in 4.11, but the data were not significantly lower from our initial screen of the the juvenile leaves for trichome density. So this is a wild type M82 plant, the domesticated tomato parent, and you can see these type 4 type 1 trichomes along the vasculature and also on the blade. But in the 4.1 plant, then you don't see the trichomes in anything like the same density on the blade of the leaf. And this is very reproducible even when you grow the plants outside in the field, which is one of the beauties of using introgression lines. They're not GMOs, so that you can grow them in the field and do field studies with them. So introgression line 4.1 and 4.11 cover this region of chromosome 4. And looking for candidate genes in these regions, we were able to find something that fell into bin 4A, which is a homolog of mixter itself. And in Solanum pinellii, it looked as though, which is where the integration line came for, it looked like the DNA binding domain of the protein had been lost. So there's a clear molecular difference between the MX2 allele in Solanum pinellii and the one in domesticated tomato. So MX2, belongs to a group of 4 mixture genes in tomato. So there's mixture 1, which I will discuss a little bit in a few minutes. And then there's mixture 3A and 3B, which look like very recent gene duplications. But we had a mutation in pinellii that looked as though it was a loss of function of mixture 2, and that was associated with reduced trichome density. So this is the pinellii allele. It lacks the DNA binding domain of the mixture gene, and this would make it very, very likely to be a knockout allele. So we have another wonderful tool in tomato that can allow you to do transient silencing of genes by viral induced gene silencing. And the tool that facilitates this is a line which we call Valencia for reasons I can't go into, which has strong anthocyanin production in the epidermis of the leaves. So it looks a sort of purpley color compared to the wild type leaves. And the purple color is controlled by 2 transcription factors, which we are expressing in an epidermal a specific promoter, and we can, if we infiltrate TRV vectors for silencing into these Valencia leaves, we can see silence sectors here, which are, and you can distinguish them from the unsilenced sectors because they're green rather than the purpley red. And so you can co-infiltrate into, well, you can add in a gene of interest to these vectors that we have that will silence the production of pigment, and you get co-silencing of your gene of interest. And so you can score the difference in the phenotype between the green sectors and the red sectors. See a very nice one here. So you can look at the control of, you can look at what your gene of interest controls by silencing in the green sector and comparing it on the same leaf to the purple sectors. So here's some data from the silencing of MX2. So this is the purple sector, and this is the silenced sector. And you can see that there's just one trichome here, and there's quite a few more on the purple sector. So there was a silencing of MX2 reduced trichome density significantly. And when we counted the effect on the different trichome types, we found a significant effect on type 5. There was a decrease in type 6 as well, but in these experiments, it was not statistically significant, but not far off. When we looked, we then did overexpression of MX2 to look at the effect of adding the gene activity. This is MX2 from, of course, from Solanum lycopersicum domesticated tomato. So this is the leaf surface of a wild type control plant, not a fantastic scanning electron micrograph. But when you overexpress MX2, then you see a huge increase in trichome density. And I want to point out here that there's actually a very significant increase in these type 6 trichomes. There's one here, one here, one here. And there's a nice one there and there. And this is rather larger than you would see, a bigger increase than you would see normally in tomato leaves. So there might be a slight preference for MX2 to induce type 6 trichomes. I just throw that out there. When we did independent lines and calculated the number of the different types of trichomes, so you can see here, these are the individual wild type primary transformants. These are the primary transformants. These are the wild type plants. You can see that there's a big increase in type 1, type 4 trichomes in all the transgenic lines. However, I would also like to point out that there is a big increase in type 6 trichomes in most of the lines, not in all of them. So these two lines didn't show a big increase in trichomes. But all of these lines did show a much more significant increase in the number of type 6 trichomes, which were really very small numbers on the wild type plants. And when you look back at the introgression line 4.1 and 4.11, the number of type 6 trichomes, which is shown by this dark gray band, is extremely small. Again, supporting the idea that MX2 might specifically initiate the formation of type 6 trichomes. So a colleague or a former postdoc in my lab, now a very senior professor in China, had already started looking at the function of another of these mixture genes in tomato when we did this MX2 work. And that was MX1, Mixtur1. And I think when Ji Lo, who did this work, started, he didn't realize that there were other Mixtur genes in tomatoes. So he cloned out this transcript and has published a very nice paper on the functionality of Mixtur1. So his paper showed that overexpression of Mixtur1 produced very, very hairy stems. And of course, RNAi she used reduced the number of trichomes on the stems. So, and scanning electron micrographs again confirmed that RNAi reduced the number of all types of trichomes, particularly these type 5, type 4 trichomes. And overexpression just produced a tangle of hairs on the leaves. And so the effects he reported on the different formation of different trichome types was that overexpression affected almost all types of trichome. So from this suggestion, it suggested that Mixtur1 will induce all trichome types. There could have been some specific effects on particular trichome types, but the numbers of these trichomes scoring in overexpression lines is very difficult to determine. So we were interested in following up the MX1 phenotype, and so we created knockout lines. And this we did by genome editing, and we produced two homozygous knockout lines, which had deletion and two small deletions in the DNA binding domain. Well, one was quite a large deletion, and these, as shown here, and we have analyzed these two independent alleles of knockout of MX1 rather than just depending on RNAi. And this is the phenotype of one of the alleles knockout on the stem. You can see that there are a few trichomes remaining, but they're nothing like as many of these type 1 trichomes on the stems. And the leaves were kind of smaller and of a slightly different shape as well. So they lose a lot of the trichomes that you see on the leaves. These are scanning electron micrographs of both alleles compared to wild type. And you can see that there is a reduced density of trichomes in both of the MX1 alleles. So quantifying that, okay, trichome density is down. Very interestingly, the stomatal density is up. It's not significantly higher than in wild type, but there was a small increase. There certainly wasn't a decrease in stomatal density. And the trichome to stomatal density, of course, went right down. So it looks like MX1 is, again, a general initiator of trichome formation. And when we counted the number, did a proper count with one of those knockout alleles, then we saw a big effect on number 5, but actually no negative effect of loss of function on type 6 trichomes. So this suggests that MX1 might have a stronger effect on the type 1, type 4, type 5 trichomes. So just generating a general model for how multicellular trichome formation may work in non-brassicaceous plants. There's an idea that you have transcriptional control and that promotes an outgrowth and cell and then subsequent cell division. But in this model that's there, there's this question of endoreduplication because this is left over from the Arabidopsis idea that there has to be endoreduplication before you can have trichome formation. And I'm not sure that we have any data to suggest that endoreduplication is essential for trichome morphogenesis in other plants. So it really needs to be re-examined very carefully. I think as in terms of a general model for how their mixture genes might be controlling trichome formation, I think you have one of the four mixture genes which promotes the expression of another transcription factor. This is a homeodomain transcription factor, which is called Woolly. And this has been defined by other people. There's suggestions that mixture genes or proteins interact with Woolly, and they then, but there's also interactions with other transcription factors, which are zinc finger transcription factors, and with other homeodomain zipper type 4 transcription factors that then go on to initiate trichome differentiation. Mixed Woolly seems to interact with CDCB2, which is not actually, it's a cyclin B2. So this is involved in promoting cell division. And so you get further rounds of cell division. So it's not, so where endoreduplication fits into this scheme is not entirely clear. Okay, so you get sent. And these other transcription factors also induce the formation of all the different trichome types. We're not sure whether there are specific developmental pathways induced prior to trichome initiation or whether this occurs after initiation has been switched on. But the type 4, type 5, type 6, and type 6 requires this gene, a basic helix loop, helix protein SLMIC1, to generate the multicellular glandular hairs at the top. And then there's type 7. So where does mixed-alike fit into this? SL mixed-alike is expressed in leaves in the general epidermal cells, and this inhibits the inhibits trichome and stomatal initiation or development. And it's quite likely, because mixed-alike is a big protein, it's not going to be diffusing laterally. It's quite likely that it inhibits DEDC because it has a very similar DNA binding domain to mixta itself, and it may be a competition between the promotion of trichomes and the mixta-like protein, which doesn't initiate trichomes. It may be a competition between these that that allows the regular space, or this causes the determination of trichome density. What about endoreduplication? Well, endoreduplication is essential for those very big unicellular trichomes that form in Arabidopsis. But if you look at the phylogenetic tree of the MIB proteins, the R2, R3 MIB proteins that are involved in the endoreduplication, then the glabrous 1 clade of proteins are pretty much restricted to the Brassicaceae. You don't see glabrous 1-like proteins outside of the Brassicaceae, suggesting that this function in endoreduplication diverged, but is essential, but just in the Brassicaceae. And its close homologue, which has been shown to be functionally identical to glabrous 1, but is expressed in roots and determines non-root hair function, that has a broader distribution, so that this werewolf protein is found in other members of the rosid family, but not in asterids, which is where tobacco and tomato and antirrhinum belong. So we think that the MBW complex controlling trichome initiation may be there because it's replaced the more ancient pathway controlled by mixta because of the need for switching on endo or initiating endoreduplication to give large unicellular trichomes. Okay, I want to finish up by just saying that, or mentioning that, one can do a lot of things with the introgression lines and examine the, because you can grow them outside and examine the relationship between trichomes that you score in different lines and other environmental stresses. So this was some work that we did on the relationship between trichome density and water stress and stomata. And we've selected not all the introgression lines. It was impossible to do these experiments with all of them, but with three lines which seem to have extremes in trichome density and M82 as a control. So we used line 4.1, which is the deletion of, or is the, is the MX2 mutant, which has reproducibly low trichome density. We used 10.2, which seemed to have reduced, but not that much reduced trichome density. We don't know the gene underlying this effect. And we used 11.3, which seemed to have relatively high trichome density from all of our introgression lines. And we were able to grow them outside. My student grew them actually in Mallorca, and a very nice place to do it, in a lovely collaboration that we had, where these differences in trichome density in the introgression lines were more or less maintained. So now I'm going to talk about traits that can be examined using integration lines, but the integration lines are not related to the mutations, or the concept here is not related to the mutations in cells. It's just a source of variation in trichome density that you can look at the effects in relation to other features, for example, stress tolerance. Now, this is stomatal density, and you can see that with 4.1, there is an elevated stomatal density compared to M82. So that idea of where you have fewer trichomes, you have more stomata, does seem to be maintained in these lines. And these are pictures of the different integration lines that we used. So these are the relationships between this variation in trichome density, or trichome over stomatal density, and water use efficiency that we were able to determine by growing plants in the field in Mallorca, either well watered. So these are the spots of color associated with well watered plants, but these were the same, and there were multiple replicates of these lines. Growing in water deficit conditions. That was 50% of the amount of water. And you can see that there is rather a nice relationship between water use efficiency and the trichome to stomata ratio. This is inherent water use efficiency, and this is whole plant water use efficiency. So this is telling us that as the trichome density goes up, and the stomatal density goes down, then the water use efficiency goes up. And this is perhaps an explanation of why so many Mediterranean plants have a very hairy, plants of the maquis vegetation are very hairy like sage, because they have a better water use efficiency when you cut down on the number of stomata and increase the number of trichomes. I also want to just say that we also used the introgression lines, pretty much the same selected introgression lines and a couple of others, to look at effects on whitefly predation. So whiteflies go through this cycle of laying eggs and then larval instars and through to back round to adults. And you can score the level of predation by whitefly by the number of pupal cases that are left on the leaves after this life cycle. So trichomes are supposed to be additionally supposed to be a deterrent for insect predation, often due to the chemicals that they produce, but we were interested also in whether density itself, hairiness itself, could confer effects on whitefly predation. So taking our selected lines, 11.3, 10.2, and 4.1, and also a couple of other lines which looked as though they might have interesting effects on density, we looked at pupal cases per leaf. And you can see that there were differences in these, but the biggest differences was with this sort of by chance line thrown in 8.1. We have mapped, we've calculated the number of whitefly pupal cases again, and we've plotted that against trichome density, and that's shown here. And there is a reasonably good inverse correlation between trichome density. So this is not taking into account the type of trichomes at all. It's not a huge effect, but the hairier lines then did have less predation. What was remarkable was that the one line that we threw in by accident, line 8.1, had consistently lower predation by insects. So this is telling us that there's something special about line 8.1. It had rather low trichome density but high resistance to trichomes. And there's a wonderful paper by Rob Last's group showing that in fact in line 8.1 it has a mutation in Solanum pinellii, which is very resistant to white flies, which affects the type of acyl sugars that are produced in type 1 and type 4 trichomes. And so it seems to be that that this general resistance to white fly is caused by these specific acyl sugars that accumulate in Solanum pinellii. And this might be a good clue to how to get something that we really need is better white fly resistance in tomato, because at least in our greenhouses, it's a really major problem. So I've come to the end of this rather technical talk, but I do want to thank the team of people who have done what is an amazing amount of very hard, repetitive counting of trichomes and calculations. So these are the third grade detectives that have really done all the work on this project. First of all, G. Lowe for characterizing the MX1 gene and alerting to me that there was a mixta gene in tomato when we dismissed it for a long time as being present. I want to thank Javier Goldenamero, a wonderful PhD student who started off all the introgression line work and who really coordinated all of that, the progress that we made on that, and enjoyed the time in Mallorca doing the field studies, I think. Lizette Acre Rodriguez from Mexico, who helped Javi with much of the characterization of the second generation of introgression lines. Michaela Andrea Navarro Coria and G. Lee. G. actually suggested this, is still with me, but she suggested this project as a good project for Javi when he started his PhD. So thank you very much for that. And thank you, Michaela, for all of your studies. I want to thank Yajuan Yu for all of the hard work that she does on tomato transformation and creating all of our genome edited lines. Man Zhao, who helped with the promoter gus staining to see where mixta-like was expressed. And Matt Downey, looking very grim here, but he is my current PhD student who is continuing Javi's work and expanding our concept of the process of control. So I think I'm at the end now, and thank you very much for your attention. And I hope I've been as clear as possible with a very complicated story. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cathie, for again another excellent talk. So I could see questions coming from Professor Rainey Borges, and she has a couple of questions. So the first one is, what about the Nevia mutant in Antirrhinum? Are those cells smooth? Also, if the amount of pigment is the same in colored and paler cells, how does this difference arise?
Okay, in the Nevia mutant, which is a chalcone synthase mutant, so it just blocks the anthocyanin pathway, but the cells are completely conical. So there's no relationship between anthocyanin production and the conical cells. They're completely separate regulatory steps. The way that the conical cells affect the light, affect the reflection, my former student, Beverly Glover, has done a lot of work on this, and it's partly due to reflectance. So when you have a cone, the light is reflected more. So you see it as brighter. You see the pigment inside as brighter because of the way that the light is reflected. And you can see this if you look at a rose, a red rose. If you look at the inside petals, you'll see that they're inside of the petals, you'll see they're dark and velvety. And if you look at the outside of the petals, it looks paler. And that's because the petals on the outside, the cells on the outside are smooth. So, and it is the difference between silk and velvet as well. It's exactly the same visual difference. I'm not a physicist, so but it, I don't really understand very well about light, but it's to do with the reflectance of light off a conical surface. Of course, the presence of conical cells on petals may have much wider functionality than just reflecting the brightness, but it is remarkable, particularly in ornamental flowers, how many of those ornamentals have very strong conical cell formation. And when the petals are not such a strong focus for insect pollinators, then and I can only say this about Solanum dulcimara, which we have looked at a little bit, then the cells of Solanum dulcimara, which attracts bees by having an anther cone, and so the cone is very bright and the petal cells are not, are much flatter in Solanum dulcimara. But of course this would be loss of a trait, and it hasn't happened in all Solanum species, so tomato still has very bright very conical cells on its petals. Is that clear? It's a really fascinating area, and something that I love to go back to and look at. I think the presence of conical cells, I mean, of course, also the conical cells on the petal will also affect the way that the volatiles are, which are made in the epidermal cells, way they're distributed. So they may well have many, many functionalities in pollination.
Yes, so the next question again from Dr. Borges, is cellular fate, trichome type and number predetermined in the leaf meristem?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. I mean, the trichomes generally initiate very early on, but at least in tomato and all the species we've looked at, I mean, there are major, you can have very big differences just depending on the environment in the greenhouse, so that if it's very humid you may well have fewer trichomes. So that's why we have to grow all our introgression lines at the same time in order to be able to get exactly the same conditions. So there's strong environmental influences.
So the third question again from Dr. Borges is, what is the relationship between herbivory and trichome density and trichome type?
Well, I think the insects find it difficult to get into the leaf and to eat whatever they eat. I mean, it's normally trying to pierce through to the vasculature and try and suck things out. Probably why the vasculature has lots of glandular trichomes on as well. So the glandular trichomes produce deterrents. For the type 1 and type 4 trichomes, where they're producing acyl sugars, it's thought that not only are they antifeedants in the acyl sugars, but they're sticky and the insects can't get off again once they're stuck in this acyl sugar. So it's a bit like glue over the leaves. So I think that there are many ways that But I mean, trichomes, I've been doing a bit of work on diterpenoids in Lamiaceae, and they're produced in the trichome. So they're clearly there as deterrents. So they're either toxins or they produce volatiles that are deterrents. So there's a very strong relationship between herbivory and trichomes. The density is just it's just a physical barrier.
Okay, so there is one more question from Dr. Laha, and it's not a question, it's kind of a comment. He says that perhaps this also explains why espinelli is susceptible to cascuta reflexa, but not the lycopersicum.
Yes, I don't know what he's talking about, but yes is the answer. Thank you.
This is Utpal.
Hello,
after 2 decades almost. Yeah. Cathie, I learned a lot from these 2 lectures, especially in today's lecture. I had no idea, but there's so much of difference in trichome development, the molecular mechanism between Arabidopsis and other species, especially tomatoes.
You can tell that I've been fighting a lone battle for more than
Oh, okay. So many types of trichome as well. So my specific question is, it's interesting that when you express a single gene in tobacco, in tomato, whether you overexpress or whether you mutate, multiple types of trichomes get affected in terms of their intensity. So what I was wondering is that all the 5-6 different type of trichomes, are they essentially same, basically same, and whether the different types originate from the level of expression in different cells, whether there's a heterogeneity in the expression level of the gene, and different levels give different identity of trichomes.
Sure about that. I mean, the different types of trichomes are localized very much and on the leaf. So first of all, your question is a fantastic question, and you can see me struggling with that concept. And we've been struggling with this for a long time. We don't have, I mean, I think MYC1 might be specific for type 6 trichomes. And okay. Looking over these slides, preparing this lecture, it suddenly struck me that there might be a relation between mixture 2 and type 6. So there seemed to be more type 6 when mixture 2 was overexpressed compared to mixture 1. But we really need to get all the mutants and all the overexpression properly counted. So there may be some specificity within the 4 mixture genes. So where was I? And I can't remember what it, I mean, it has been proposed that it's a general trichome initiation and then something happens. The idea of having to measure gene expression in the different trichome types is ghastly. but maybe this, we can do something fancy
The idea is actually borrowed from, if you see the Adrian Roeder's work and in petals, Arabidopsis petals, have giant cells and you have non-giant cells. So the two identity are actually given by the expression level of the different expression level of the same gene.
It's not something that we've explored. I mean, at the moment, we're trying, Matt is valiantly trying to get knockouts of every gene involved in initiation so that we can try and build a model for how all of these things work. But I mean, I think that the Artemisia people they have very similar view. And I heard an Artemisia talk very recently. I didn't get it all, but I must go back and look at it, where they are saying that mixture also has a, I mean, I have a big argument with Matt as whether woolly is the initiator or whether mixture is the initiator. Mm. Because if you overexpress woolly, not if you take the mutation of woolly, which makes woolly petals, but that's a protein change. But if you overexpress woolly, you don't get more trichomes. So that makes me think that it's not the primary initiator. So that's why in my model mixture it turns on woolly. But that's something that we need to work out. Sorry, it's a very personal discussion here.
Yeah. All right, Cathie, thanks a lot.
Thank you, Opal. Lovely to talk to you.
So next question comes from Dr. Usha Vijayaraghavan. She wants to know, can mixed overexpression in Pinelli alter trichome density and development?
Oh, we haven't done that one yet. But I expect it could. Especially if we try to, what we should do, I mean, doing crosses with Pinelli is not so easy. So we should do a transformation of MX2 from like a persicum into a Pinelli and see if we can get something more from, to get more trichomes. But Pinelli is very hairy anyway. Does one want a hairier Pinelli? I'm not sure.
Yeah, so the next question comes from Samar Singh, and he is curious to know cuticle biosynthesis, whether cuticle biosynthesis affects the trichome morphogenesis or not.
Well, it's ASF has certainly shown, and I think very convincingly shown, that mixed alike in flowers affects cuticle development. And so that ties in with his, I can't remember the name of the protein, but the one that makes, that initiates cuticles in petals. So I think that mixed alike it does. I'm not sure whether mixed genes themselves initiate cuticle development, but it's absolutely clear that when you have a conical cell outgrowth, whether it's in a petal or whether it's in a trichome, you've got to have more cuticle, because the outgrowth is always on the cuticular side. So if you, and yeah, you never see an outgrowth going in which doesn't require a cuticle. So there is a relationship between mixta and cuticle development, yes. And mixta light definitely initiates cuticle production.
Oh, okay, so one more question comes from Usha. She asks, what are your thoughts on cellular factors downstream of mixta that orient cell outgrowth or mitosis?
That's another long-standing question. I think there are several things that, and this is all unpublished work that needs to be needs to be verified by Matt. Looking at mixta years ago, I actually had an Indian PhD student who did some differential display to look for the targets of mixta. And we saw, because the differential display turned up a lot of potential genes, we explored some of those. And there seemed to be two things. The first thing was that there were a lot of kinases that were switched off. And one important one was a receptor-like kinase, which we think is involved in stabilizing cell wall so that it maintains, let's say it stabilizes cell walls so that you don't get reorientation of growth. So if you imagine that you've got to change the polarity of growth for an outgrowth to initiate, then you can imagine that you need to switch off this receptor-like kinase to facilitate the outgrowth. Now, I had a wonderful PhD student called Kim Bauman, and she did a lot of stuff with looking at actin and tubulin. And it's quite clear that when you have the outgrowth starting, which I think is the start of the trichome initiation as well, you have to have a reorientation of the microtubules. That's clear. But what we found was that the reorientation of the microtubules so that they start to go circular around the outgrowth, that occurred in a wider domain than the actual outgrowth. This was all work done in tobacco, labeling tubulin. And doing live imaging. So I suspect that the reorientation of the tubulin microtubules is permissive, but it doesn't actually dictate the precise location of the outgrowth. And that may be determined by local changes in the cell walls. So there were some data from root hair outgrowths that perhaps specific expansins loosen the wall at the tip, just in the localized position, responding to changes in pH, and that those then allow the reorientation of growth. So those are my clues as to what might be happening. That there, and we did find that one specific expansin was responsive to it, so it was upregulated by mixta, but of course it has to work locally within the cell, and how that localized action of the expansin occurs, I have no idea. But this deposition of an expansin in a specific place allows loosening of the cell walls, and a reorientation of growth that is directed by the reorientation of the cellulose microtubules. That's again, it's a hand wavy answer, but it's the best I can do at the moment. It's a lot of, it's a big challenge to try and understand what I think is a really fascinating conundrum, that is a transcription factor can reorientate growth and change the polarity of growth.
So there is one more question, which the question is, how conserved do you think is the role of mixta across Solanaceae?
Across Solanaceae, it's absolutely conserved. There's no problem about that. We showed it in Petunia. It's definitely conserved. I would say that, so mixta is an ancient R3 MIB transcription factor, unlike GL1, which is derived from, actually GL1 is derived from the regulators of anthocyanin biosynthesis. So there is a mixta homologue in Fiscometrella, and there I think it might be involved in branching of hyphal growth. So I think it's a very ancient, so my view, and I, you know, this is my view, not everybody else's view, but my view is that mixta and its control of trichomes is the ancient pathway, and GL1 have just hijacked this overall mechanism to make a trichome, and they've come in as a new primary regulatory module. But I could be wrong.
No, I think if I remember, also in Malvaceae, it has been connected with kind of a development and like fiber development, if I'm not wrong. So that's what I could recall. So, So I don't see any other question in chat box. Then I would ask the last question possibly to Cathie. So I was wondering, since you already said that you would be possibly doing some CRISPR lines you are doing, so out of those four mixta, if they are having different trichome types of trichome, will it be either because their target genes are different, because these are transcription factors? Might be one way. Another way of looking at it, I think, if I don't know how much sequence similarity they have at the protein level, is it possible that they have different interacting partners, and therefore the association of different, you know, partner groups is making this kind of a change in the type of trichome?
Very smart question, Subha. And so I think that the sequence difference is between mixta 3A and 3B is so minor that they are unlikely to have different functions. So we're down to three. They have different expression patterns. So that's one thing that we have to explore. But I think just a hint that they might have different targets comes from this business about the type 6 trichomes. And a clear candidate for a different target for MX2 is the MIC1. So that's something that's relatively easy for us to test. The problem is at the moment that we only have the knockout in Pinellii, and that's not a close enough knockout, or the integration line is probably not close enough to really do proper RNA-seq to see different targets. So Matt's busy trying to make a knockout of MX2 in Solanum lycopersicum. And absolutely, looking at interacting partners, I mean, mixta has been reported to interact, or mixta-like genes have been reported to interact with woolly, and there's all those other genes that have been defined in tomato that we need to look at. But it's also very likely that there are differences in interacting partners. So we can't answer that at the moment, but we're working on it.
Yes, so maybe we would wait till you come physically, and
yes,
by the
time then I can tell you the answer.
I think then we are at the end of the today's talk, and from my own behalf, as well as from the on behalf of the academy, I would like to thank you, Cathie, profusely for coming and giving these two online lectures as Janaki Ammal Chair Professorship to 2020 lecture. And You know, it's a lot to learn from you for both the area of the science, that's true, and hope to receive you sometime next year when all of us are in a safer world. I hope to have it sooner. And also, you know, thanks to Utpal and Usha, who are already here. We all were waiting very, very much that you would be visiting all our institution. So anyway, that could be done later on. And I also thank all the participants and all the people who have posed so many questions. So to make the session very lively, and that's the best part of it. And thank you, Cathie. And
thank you, Shubha, and thank you, Partha, and thanks to Utpal and everyone. I've really enjoyed it, and I'm definitely coming.